Well done, Ron.
Oh, dear.
Thank you, Billy.
Oh, our hearts were stopping. You weren't going to come through that door.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. Well, there's been a bit of a traffic jam and this one and the other.
Well, but we've got a lot of presents wrapped up for you at the studio, so let's go. Yeah. This is part of your audience we brought here by coach. They're coming back as well.
But I can't even join myself.
Norman Wisdom, king of comedy mayhem, this is your life, and your first taste of anything even remotely connected with show business came 50-odd years ago when you enlisted as a teenage army band boy and learned to play the trumpet, especially the regimental march of the Royal 10th Hussars in India. But more than 40 years ago, you enlisted in quite a different regiment, show business.
Train chunk! Squad will move to the right. Quick, march!
Your call from the Grand Order of Water Rats, Henry Cooper.
And every morning, Norman, I walk there with you.
Davy Kay! John Pershley! Derek Stacy! David Lodge! Bernie Clifton, Freddie Davis, Bill Pershley, Percy Edwards, Ben Wallace, Vince Hill, Charlie Chester, and Roy Castle. Just turn to you, Henry. Henry, you know, Norman's been quite a handy fighter in his time. Did you know that?
Oh, he's a bit useful at my old game, he was. They tell me we got a lot in common because they tell me he was his battalion champion, the 10th Hussars, and I was my battalion champion. But I must say, you know, he's got some great eccentric walks and he tumbles. He's a great clown, isn't he? People used to hit me on the chin. I used to walk like him, and I used to fall, and I didn't used to get a laugh. But he's made millions laugh in his lifetime, and might be always be so, Norman.
But that's how, I, you know, I learned to fall. You see, I used to get walloped more than you.
I don't know.
And I used to fall there, boom, boom.
Oh. Well, Norman, this is your life, and today, after more than 40 years at the top, you've won a whole new generation of fans with the popular television showbiz of your hit comedy films, which packed the nation's cinemas in the 50s and 60s.
Up there like that. There we are. Feel that? Your elbow. Oh, oh. Take it away. Oh! Gotcha. Cross your legs. Oh! Gotcha.
Relax.
Turn it round. Wrong way, sir. Better come right off with it. I'm terribly sorry, Paco.
Oh, great success, Norman. Alas, though, of course, sadness when your marriage failed, but there were compensations, which is why I know one of your favorite film successes was Follow a Star, in which you had two very special co-stars. Then, aged just six, your son Nick. And who's this in the same movie?
No.
Yes, it is. Then, aged just four. And, of course, they're both here, your daughter Jackie and son Nick. Nick, tell me, was your dad as much fun at home as he was on the screen?
Oh, he certainly was, Eamon. And I can tell you there were some chaotic scenes at dinner time. He used to put his elbows on the table and then they'd slip and he'd go straight into a plate of porridge or anything like that, and he used to be horrendous.
Well, from this picture, it looks as though you were helping him. So, Jackie, you both missed him, of course, when work took him away from home.
Oh, yes, definitely, Eamon. But the good thing about Dad going away was that when he used to come back with lots of presents for us. Mm.
Yeah? Such as?
Ooh, nice bits of jewellery, necklaces, whatever.
Porridge.
But he also bought me a pony. And when we first got Jasmine, Dad insisted that he was the first to ride her. Do you remember that, Dad?
Yes, I do. Mm.
And she threw him,
yeah.
Which amused the few onlookers there, which wasn't planned for Dad, unfortunately.
Wasn't deliberate, Dad.
Norman, you were brought up in London's Paddington in the tough times of the 20s. Your late father was a chauffeur and your mother a dressmaker. Home was at 91 Fernhead Road.
Right, yeah.
And every morning you walked the 400 yards to this school, St. Luke's.
And every morning, Norman, I walked there with you.
Neighbor and school pal, the local grocer's son. You haven't seen each other for more than 60 years. Jack Bangay. Jack, you have gone to become a success, too, as a company director, but was Norman something of a character even in those boyhood days?
Very much so. I could tell a few tales. But the thing that people remember him mostly for was the wonderful story of when he was knocked down by a bicycle and hurt his ear and was lying there in the road crying his eyes out. And along came a dear old lady and she said, "Oh, my little fellow, what's wrong? I think I can stop your crying." So she opened her purse and said, "Here we are. Here's a little silver sixpence. This'll stop your crying." And it did. But what people don't remember is the next morning he was in the same place trying to be knocked down again.
Thank you, Jack Bangay.
Thank you.
Well, Norman, sadly, your parents were divorced, and you and your late elder brother Fred were put into care, first in Hertfordshire, then at Deal in Kent.
Yes.
Leaving school, you find work as an errand boy locally before returning to London, looking like this in your first grown-up suit and trilby. Oh, very smart. Now, you get hotel jobs as page boy, then waiter, cabin boy on a freighter to South America, and army band boy. You take up boxing and, in fact, become the flyweight champion of the regiment in India. But you're always making your army pals laugh. And back in England, your army service completed, you resolved to get into show business. But before you could do anything about that, war was declared. You find yourself in 1939 back in the army, this time on the Royal Signals. Now, at Cheltenham, you're in the unit dance band. That's you on the saxophone.
Yes.
Playing at weekly dances.
And one night, when the band took their break, you got your own very first solo break in front of an audience.
Your great army pal of those more than 45 years ago, Patrick Dickinson. Now, tell us about the night of the dance, Patrick.
Well, I was sort of on the entertainment committee, and everyone used to rush to the bar when the interval came. So, in our wisdom, we thought of a plan to keep people back, and I suggested, if the band took a turn to entertain us, we could stop people rushing to the bar, you see. So they all took a turn. And when Norman's turn came, he did some mimes. And I can remember three of them. One of them was paper tearing. One of them was dancing with ladies of all shapes and sizes. And the other one was the boxing routine.
And they all made them fall around the place. Thank you, Patrick Dickinson.
Imagine, ladies. Yeah, that's right.
Well, after DeMott, you decide to have another crack at being a professional comedian. Your persistence pays off, and you're given a chance down the bill at the old Collins Music Hall in 1946. You get music hall bookings up and down the country, and in 1947, a big break in a charity show at London's Victoria Palace with Laurel and Hardy, top of the bill. Now, your rise up the bill begins the following year when someone pops into the theatre to catch your act, a very influential impresario then and now, Lord Delphont.
Hello, Norman.
Hello, Bernie.
You played an important part in my professional life in the world of entertainment. It all started as far back as the late 1940s, when I was presenting some of the famous American headliners who were making their first appearances in this country after the war at the London Casino. However, I was looking to include unknown English artists to be given an opportunity. My very close colleague for well over 40 years, Billy Marsh, who is your agent and with you, begged me to put you into one of these programs. Yes, I said, okay, but he can only be allowed 8 minutes as I had a very big program. On the opening night, however, you did half an hour and you absolutely stopped the show. You are a legendary British star that will entertain the public for years to come. Thanks, Norman.
Thank you, Lord Delphont. Well, your career was taking off, yet amazingly, you'd yet to invent that cloth-capped character in a too-tight suit. Now, that happened in Scarborough one day when the magician on the bill, the late and much missed David Nixon, asked you to help him by pretending to mess up one of his tricks. You'd pretend to be a customer coming up from the audience, and you went out and bought the outfit, didn't you?
Yes.
What did it cost you?
30 bob for the suit and a shilling for the cap.
And even today, you wear that suit in cabaret with your longtime partner, Tony Fain, and it's that buttoned-up suit, cloth cap askew in 1953, you endear yourself into the nation in the film Trouble in Store. The first of 19 hilarious movies over two decades which bring comparisons with the early Chaplin. 1955 sees you in this one, and the title song was a big hit too.
The moment, the man of today, if he's the man of the moment, I'm happy to say, but he's not here for the moment, a man on his way, just the man of the moment for today.
And for our man of the moment tonight, they're right here, always the girls of the moment, the Beverly Sisters. Oh.
Today,
it's
his
mum
and all. Happy birthday.
Lovely to see you.
Girls, I understand there was, in fact, quite a moment. Have it. Sit down, Owen. Tell us about another moment, girls, at that charity concert at the London Coliseum.
Well, that was 34 years ago.
Oh, my goodness.
Now, it was a very swanky gala occasion, all international celebrities, for the Lynmouth Flood Disaster Fund, you must remember. Yeah. We remember, anyway. And we just finished our act. We finished our act and went running off for our applause. And I slipped on a custard pie, went flying, hit my head on the microphone on the floor and went out totally cold. Well, it put Norman in a dilemma because the opening of Norman's act, you walk on and do a spectacular fall.
Yes.
Right, right. But this moment proved that Norman Wisdom was a very big man because without any hesitation...
He did a most beautiful thing. He strode out onto that vast stage, this little
notice.
Character with his little shrunken suit and cap on, and he scooped Babs up in his arms and gallantly carried her off.
He did.
Well, thank you for the Beverly Sisters.
He really was the man of the moment.
He was the man of the moment. The man.
Congratulations. By the mid-50s, Norman, put him down. You were certainly going up in the world, and appropriately enough, going up in the world was the title of your smash hit 1956 movie, in which you played a window cleaner who falls in love with a girl who's a maid.
I've a feeling of being so up in the world when I'm walking out with you. Up in the world is the feeling I get even talking about you. I can
Well, Norman, looks like the window cleaner and the maid had a head for heights.
I didn't. I never told you, did I, Norman? I actually suffer from vertigo.
Your fictional maid became a real-life countess you haven't met for 25 years. Former actress Maureen Swanson, the Countess of Dudley. Maureen, you must still be surprised you survived that scene, suffering as I know you do from vertigo.
Yes, I do suffer very badly from that.
I wonder why you kept holding on to me.
But the moment you started to sing to me, Norman, my fears were gone, and I consider it was the Norman conquest of my fears.
But Maureen, there was another hidden horror, wasn't there, as far as you were concerned?
Yes, rodents. Except, of course, water rats. I'm absolutely petrified of them. But, Norman, you had the bright idea, didn't you, of producing that little hamster, Harold? Mm. And I had to hold it and love it. Well, all I can say is that I should have been given an Oscar for bravery. So, but it is wonderful for me to be here tonight.
Thank you. Maureen Swanson, Countess of Dudley. Thank you. Thank you. Well, for all your cinema success, Norman, you're always in great demand for the stage, including, of course, the world-famous London Palladium. Two great comedy talents there, and tonight that other decorator is taking a holiday break with his wife at her home in Puerto Rico, but not even the in-laws can keep him from the nearest golf course. Your old pal, Bruce Forsyth.
Hello, Eamon, and hello there, Norman. Well, now, when This Is Your Life do these film bits from overseas, the people always say, I'm sorry I can't be with you tonight. Well, I'm not. I'm not a hypocrite. No, I mean, here I am at Hyatt's Dorado Beach in Puerto Rico, probably one of the finest golf and tennis and hotel resorts in the world. So, I mean, I've just had 18 holes of golf. I'm just going to have a pina colada, if you'll pardon the expression. And then after that little light lunch, maybe another 9 holes of golf or a little bit of tennis. And then dinner under the stars. So how can I say, I'm sorry, I can't be with you? But what I can say is, Norman, I hope you're having a wonderful, wonderful evening. And you know, you're someone I will always, always admire. So have a marvellous time. Oh, and Norman, if you decide to do the dance at the end of the show, make sure that Eamon does the leading. He's very touchy about that. Well, I think that's about all. I'm sorry you can't be here with me. Bruce Forsyth, News at 10, Puerto Rico. Oh, no, wait a minute. No, Bruce Forsyth, This Is Your Life. Puerto Rico. Do you like the outfit? I'm flying the flag. Go out on the legs, Carl. Go out on the legs. That's where the action is. Right.
Thank you. Bruce Forsyth in Puerto Rico. Norman, in the early 70s, you played in Summer Season with a rising young comedy star from Liverpool who used to watch your act from the wings.
And to me, pal, you'll always be the greatest.
In those days, star in name only, but today, star indeed, Freddie Starr.
No.
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Grimsdale.
No. I've been
I know, Freddie, that you found his particular brand of comedy quite an inspiration, didn't you?
Yeah. I based myself on Norman, you see, and I've always admired him brilliantly. After being on stage, if sometimes you got a duff audience, you know, like we got tonight. I'm only joking. Shut up. I'd come up and say to him, the audience are a bit duff tonight, and I used to go outside, give him false information, and so he'd come on thinking that there were terrible audience, but they weren't. And he used to do things for me on stage. He'd give me that whistle, because that used to crack me up. From that film where Jerry Desmond pinched your voice.
Oh, yeah.
And you were sat in the audience watching him on the film going, go on, get in. Go on, mate. And I always used to ask him to do that thing for me, just to brighten me up. It was brilliant. And Norman, may I say this to you, you've inspired me in my profession, and you're a gentleman, you're a true professional, and you're a genius, and you're a legend. And I love you, dear.
Thank you, Billy Carr. Well, Norman, you're at the top of your profession in the late 60s, and your film career here doesn't go unnoticed by Hollywood. In 1968 comes the perfect role for you there, playing burlesque in The Night They Raided Minsky's.
From head to toe, I'm a masterpiece. You should hang in the loo. When I drink tea now, I don't lick the spoon. And I always stick my pinky up when I dunk my Luna Doon.
Well, it's plain to see you're a gentleman. If I say it, it's true. Look in that looking glass, all you will see is class.
I've got that certain style, boy, it speaks out a mile.
Man of propriety,
toast of society, a regular gentleman.
Playing your partner there, one of the great names of the New York stage as well as cinema, and it's from New York he talks to you now, Jason Robards.
Oh, cool. Dear Norman, this is your old friend Jason. I haven't seen you for 20 years, but I always remember what a wonderful time we had working together. I'm so glad to be part of this tribute to you and to wish you a very happy birthday. And I always remember the song that we sang together, From Head to Toe, You're a Gentleman. And I can only say that about you. Happy, happy birthday. God bless. I hope we see each other soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Jason Robards. Norman, I'd like to remind you again of your days as a band boy with the Royal 10th Hussars at Lucknow in India more than half a century ago. There's a great old picture from India at the time of the British Empire. There's that cavalry band with young Norman Wisdom among the trumpeters. Very nostalgic. Very impressive. But your band duties weren't always so impeccably carried out. One evening, you're the duty trumpeter detailed to sound the call summoning officers to the mess.
Yes, and you got there late, didn't you, Scruffy?
He was there that day in India 54 years ago, Hussars trooper Roger Tiny Willits. What's this you call Norman Scruffy?
Well, he was always known as Scruffy in the regiment, and he was always late.
Well, now, so what happened the evening he was due to sound the officer's mess?
Yes, well, he was duty trumpeter with the main guard, and he got a sound officer's mess, but he had to use a bicycle. And, of course, he was always late, and he pedalled off down through the barracks, and when he got there, he didn't have time to jump off and stand to attention, so he sat on the bicycle and sounded it and got caught by the ordinary officer, which he did a few jankers. But anyway, he came up smiling. And he was a regimental comedian, good trumpeter, and sometimes he did a bit of citizen.
Thank you, Tony Willits. Well, Norman, it's 34 years since the little man who plays the fool won the nation's hearts in his very first film. Still your favorite, I know. Few left the local cinema without a moist eye after this scene.
Don't laugh at me, 'cause I'm a fool. I know it's true, yeah. I'm a fool. No one seems to care. I'd give the world to share my life with someone. my lucky times, I'm a
The girl who captured your heart and ours is here tonight, Lana Morris.
Oh. When you sang that to me 30 years ago, it made me cry.
Oh,
and
good.
It's just on the same thing now.
Lana, that of course may have been fiction, but in fact, that scene remains in so many memories as real, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. I want to tell you something. I was on tour in Cardiff last year, and I was just walking along the street, and a young man dashed up to me and he gave me a rose. And it was lovely. And do you know what he said? He said, "That's for being so nice to Norman in those films." So I want to give it to you. It's his high love and admiration, and from all your fans. Happy birthday.
You're still as nice as ever.
Thank you.
Norman Wisdom, comedy legend, this is your life. Yeah.